is, and you know, learned something from the last place's lessons intensively about failures. And I was preparing a talk, I was thinking of sharing some of the failures I had, and I had several of them. But now I'm happy since we had so great stories about failures that I want to share something which is just actually tackling me since several months. And it's coming out of my work of the last 5 years, which I did with a lot of students at the HBI and the Hasselblad Institute, at this thing which is called the School of Design Thinking, which is very, very important, design thinking, which we call the Indie School. And I would like to share a metaphor. I was actually looking through the last 5 years, I was so often asked by people, what is design thinking? What are you doing? And why are so huge companies, like big media companies, big transportation and communication companies are approaching you, few guys. What do they want? And they came up with a metaphor which helps me to organize and to navigate into this kind of denser network of change, which we are seeing all over the places with this incredible pressure to change. And thus, me, it might help you as well. Did that work? Right? Students while they're learning. And our students are close to their partners, they're all writing their thesis, their master's, their diploma, or their PhD thesis, so they know they are kind of knowledgeable in their field. But that's what they join forces and they try to think cross borders. Because you might see the interesting things nowadays which are happening between A and K and C and Z and so on. Not too much within. And that's what we're looking towards. The other thing to be heard. Let's move on. The other thing is how do we approach innovation? How do we look at new things? What is the most inspirational source, the best inspirational source for coming up with solutions for complex problems? And if you could do one thing, this is technology, this is business, and this is human values. Usually what we're doing in science, we're approaching from this perspective. We ask how strong what we're doing, what are the huge research institutions are doing. We look at different business models. We try to find out what are the guys at South Korea doing, what's in Japan going on, what's in Silicon Valley, let us think. How can we adapt that? How can that be helpful for us? We are saying the most inspirational source is the human being, is the person. Looking at people needs first. So that's what we're trying to encourage our students all the time. And it sounds so easy. We have done about 80 projects now for the last 5 years with huge companies, small, medium-sized institutions, public institutions, governmental institutions, non-NGOs, and most of the time, especially the large institutions, the large companies, they have such a hard time to put themselves into the perspective of looking at human needs and needs which are really addressable. And that's what we always ask people for desirability. How should a product or a service look like? And in order to be the right thing. The other thing is what we are doing, I could explain with those three little things. With this little people. So we're focusing, we don't focus too much on the power of teams. We don't focus too much on the power of individual, this individual person. We focus too much on the power of the whole team, the creative power of the whole team. And this might sound very simple to you, but if you look at our education system, kindergarten, school, university, this is not the normal thing that you're doing. You're always focusing on the power of the individual. This starts in kindergarten, this is piling up at school, and this is even more focused on in the university. If I would ask you, who of you is doing or did his or her final thesis in the university as a team? Two. Wow. And you are ESCP students? Yep, you are. Great. So, just a little proof of. Imagine my question. The answer to my question would have been all of you were raising your hand except two. And those two would have to explain why they are doing this on their own and not as a team. But this is not how society runs, and this is not how education runs. Really into that system. The other thing is, if we have those teams, we have to give them a certain process. And this is basically this six steps: understand, observe, define, point and do, ideate, prototype, and test. This is the process which we're giving to those teams. Very simple steps. Actually, this is coming out of the thinking and doing of designers. And that's what's giving the name to design thinking. This little process of six steps. And the core things here is observation, What we do is we send our students out. They learn by going out and looking at people's needs. We did several projects in the last semester, for example, trying to find out how the future of a shopping bag looks for CNA. Do we need a shopping bag in the future? Or we did another project about a company diabetes juice patients and find out how could they change their life or how could we help people prevent it to step into diabetes to be a patient, become a patient. We did another project where we followed nurses in South Africa. A student team went to South Africa to try to help them at their daily work while they're driving around with their little mobile hospitals to help to organize to make their life better, to make their life easier. So this kind of things we are doing. And we're sending out students there all over the world trying to find out what are the actual needs. And the other thing that we're doing is the prototyping. And I just want to focus on those two, because this is something which we usually don't do too often. Designers do that, architects do that, some other groups of people do that. But most of our students are human students. They never did that. They never do very intense observation with humans. They read a lot of articles, they read a lot of books, they read a lot of statistics, and they don't do prototyping. So what we're asking them, challenging them, is everything that you're doing, everything that you're trying, every project, do prototype. And the third thing is, you have to do this in a special space, in a special setting. You cannot just go to any conference room or a seminar room. And I'm just drawing here our chairs and our tables and our whiteboards we developed, which are supporting the team. We need team support, supportive space. If you look at the normal setting, a normal conference room, this kind of space here is not supporting the team, that's supporting the individual to present something to a lot of people. We could arrange that easily to do it to have a team space, and I hope that ACP has a lot of team spaces and workspaces where we can work together. But if I look at a normal setting in the university, you see seminar rooms, you see sometimes laboratories where people are working together. So we have a special setup. And one thing we're focusing on is more, everything's moving around. And now I'm coming to my little metaphor, which I developed. And it's really annoying that the thing is still here. But I still had to. So, why is it important? Why is it so important to learn to collaborate, to learn to work together across borders? That's because we are living in a world which I would call a network society. You're talking about this all the time. I try to draw this little stupid drawing just to display this chaotic network of things, and it's actually wrong to do it in a static way. We are living in a world which is, there's a pulsating, three-dimensional network which is growing and growing, getting denser and denser and denser. And we are all living in that world. We are all witnesses of this happening right now. For the last 20 years we saw internet develop. For the last 5 years we saw something happen with these little devices here, with those glass things we can work on. And change our behavior, quite a bit. And it's all, and then now we see the social networks and getting denser and denser and denser. We're putting a lot of pressure of change on all of us, as an individual, but also to companies, institutions. And the problem is, I was asked, why is that? And what are you doing? What are you offering at the school? And the metaphor I found was not looking towards where you're going, but more looking, what are you leaving now? What is the thinking we are leaving? And I found, I'm using, since several months, I'm using this little drawing, and I call this the Brockhouse thinking. And for those of you not familiar with German Brockhaus, this is the encyclopedia everyone knows here. And everyone has used as a kid, and also in school, and also clear if you want to find out something about some topic, look at it. Grab the book, read it. If I'm asking you now who's owning this American cancer computer, I have. Not a large one, not only not the Rock House, but also my resident. Close to my age. So when did you look in last time? So the interesting thing with using that metaphor is it shows that this model of organizing knowledge doesn't work anymore. We don't do this. We might have a real-time access. What we are doing is we might have a network version. But the problem is, our thinking, the back of our mind, is structured like this, like Brockhaus. This I can get rid of this one again. I can write up here, let's say, not to be offensive, Humboldt University, or HPI. And you see the different departments. We not only structure our knowledge, we also structure our reality, institutions, with this pattern. And also companies. You could say, here for example, humans, some other company, I don't want to blame anybody. Because you see immediately the different departments, they line up. And what is happening in reality, and this is what is so important to me, you see that every day doing a lot of work. Is Department A is fighting against Department B and Department C. They're not collaborating, they're not working together. They try hard. They try also to have hard humor or good humor, but they still, they have no chance. And this is because our whole education system, for 15 years, we are trained to think that way. We're not trained to think that way. We're not trained to think. And this is what we have to change. And this is what we try to do in the university. This is what some schools, ESCP in Berlin, is trying to do in the school. Try to break this up, try to get rid of those strict, limiting, and distinct structures and come more, think more in a network way. But the problem is, we are on this way right now. And I would consider myself to be maybe here, not there. Maybe you, the students here at ECP, maybe here. But also you, you're running through the same education system. You have this all on your back. And be aware of this all the time. That you're carrying this burden. And this is, since I'm using that metaphor, it helps me to think of things differently. And also, I'm looking at my daily work in a different way. And I have a little 4-year-old son. This is my private story. And I see him now walking towards his school system. And I don't want to see him ending up. I see him, oh my God, he's welcoming. He's interested in everything, and he wants to connect with everything, and he's interested in everybody. And I see him coming out of a school system, which is bringing him into this kind of thinking. And we all know, Brockhaus disappeared. The business model disappeared. It's not longer there. The whole process of going from this kind of thinking to a network thinking is irreversible. We will not have, in 10 years from now, the situation where we go back to our bookshelf and say, yeah, the 14 books of Brockhaus' latest edition in 2020 is there, now we are rescued. No. Which means we have to be prepared for this, and I will see my little son with a smiley face. Within the next years, and not with ADHS or other symptoms where we are thinking this is a disease, but it's just caused because we are treating the kids, we are trying to train kids the wrong thinking, the connected problem. But I wish to you, this